welcome to this very unusual edition of Off the Cuff. Unusual because in this one, instead of talking to someone from outside, we talk amongst ourselves. Pranoy and Dorab, just what we journalists want journalism to be. We just talk amongst ourselves.
Exactly.
But you guys deserve the honor of being at the other end, with me having to do the homework, which I have done.
For once in your life.
For once. Or maybe for once I haven't.
Yeah.
to question the two of you, because you've committed the crime of writing this book, and they are so embarrassed about it, they are not even willing to hold it up. So I have to hold it up for them. That's the story of my life. I have to account for other people's crimes. So Pranoy, let me start with you. Yogendra Yadav, our mutual friend, he said that 7 PhDs can come out of this book. Now, what PhDs would these be?
Well, actually, I thought that comment was the most rewarding of any comment that after writing a book. Because he's India's finest psephologist, including us. He's much better. And we learned a lot from him over the years. And he called it a seminal contribution to election studies, and that 7 PhDs can come out of it. From him, that just meant everything, and he helped a lot in an earlier draft. Well, one of the, I think, major findings in this book, and other people have worked on it before, but I think we've taken it to another level, is that there are 21 million women in India who are over 18, eligible to vote, but are not allowed to vote because they're not on the electoral rolls. 21 million women. That is more than 30,000 women per constituency. And of course, there's this great north-south divide. In the south, women are registered properly on the electoral rolls. It's almost 100%. In the north, many, many women are missing. And the worst, both in percentage terms and in absolute terms, is Uttar Pradesh. 6.8 million women are missing on the rolls of Uttar Pradesh. That works out to 85,000 women per constituency in Uttar Pradesh have the right to vote, but are not allowed to vote because of a technicality of not being on the electoral rolls. Now, we found this. We went to the Election Commission, and they are aware of it, and they really have tried hard. So I think the one PhD is, why are these women not on the electoral rolls? Somebody needs to study it. Somebody needs to rectify it, because it's a travesty of our democracy.
Dorab,
one, you know, if you ever watch elections, hopefully on NDTV, you see leads coming in. Supposing when all the leads, you know, leads come in by rounds, first round, second round, as they count. As leads come in, supposing at the end of all 100% of the leads have come in, say in Maharashtra, 48 constituencies all have come in, and a certain party is winning 25 seats, you would assume that when all the rounds are counted, it will win about the same number of seats. But no, there is a bump, which Shekhar discovered. It's actually, somebody could do a lot of work. We've shown 5 or 6 elections, because in every election, we keep a track of which constituency reports how many rounds at what time. So we actually know what happened. And we find suddenly, as more and more rounds are counted, a party just moves up and up and up. And there is a statistical reason for it. If you don't understand it, write to Doc Ghosh, who's also listed in the acknowledgements. He'll tell you the statistical reason why it happens. It really is something that deserves much more work.
Do women vote like men anymore? Or are they voting differently now?
Absolutely not. Women have become increasingly independent in their decision making. 20 years ago, when we used to go to villages, they were like standing next to their husbands and saying, "Jo batayenge, I'll vote like that." Now you ask them, they say, "I talk to him? Who's he?" And the husband sits quietly. And all the surveys also show that women's voting pattern is very different from men. Not only that, they're participating much more than men now. In assembly elections, the turnout of women is higher than the turnout of men. It used to be 20% behind men. Rural women turnout is 5 to 7% higher than urban turnout.
And if this many women were not missing, this gap would be even greater.
Yes, yes, the gap would be even greater. Also, you know, if you think about it, say 30 odd years ago when some of us were around, you know, you heard stories of at night the village people gathering together with the sarpanch and the village elders and deciding who to vote for. I think with the coming of media, people have seen wider exposure. So now, not even men, but also women. Everybody is making their own choice. In fact, we met a man in Lucknow this time, where in his household, he was voting for one party, his wife for another party, and his mother for a third party. And they all had reasons.
Tell me, from a period when we just had waves, usually when you had a big leader, you had a big wave, and nothing else mattered. Have we seen our voters move towards the economy sometimes, or are they still stuck with identity?
I think it's a very difficult answer to give. They're both. But the question is, what, as you see votes move from election to election, you see how, you know, what happens to me? The country may be growing at 8%. But, you know, if my, I don't have water, I don't have education, I don't have bijli, you know, this matters much more to the voter. What are you doing for me? Don't tell me about the big plans you have. Give it to me. So, you know, they are becoming much more transactional, much more judicious. Of course, there is caste. Of course, there is, you know, charisma. But this is a very, very important thing now in terms of who you vote for.
I think one of the old-fashioned ways of looking at elections, which all of us tend to do, is there a wave this time? Is the vote going to go up hugely? Popular vote used to be very, very important. Almost 70% of seats used to be decided by popular vote. It's no longer that. Only 50% of seats are decided by alliances and 50% by popular vote. It's that much change. And that is a huge change in politics. When two parties get together, there's a lot of theorizing, oh, will their votes combine? By and large, they always combine plus a boost. Because when there's an alliance, people see, oh, this is a group that can get a higher chance of winning. And it kind of attracts more voters. So you, when you get an alliance, you get the summation of both their votes plus an average of 8%, which is huge.
How do you see the tussle between economy and identity? Essentially caste and economy.
I like the way you put it, because it's always a tussle. It's not like all economy or all caste. I mean, there's no situation in which any one caste is 100% for anybody. Even the Jatavs or the Jadavs and Yadavs in UP won't be all voting for their particular parties. They're split. So amongst each of them, economy changes. If the economy is not doing well, yes, less Yadavs will vote for you if you're in the ruling front, etc. So both matter. But I think, as Dorab said, it's not the GDP, because GDP can be reflected in growth in cities, in growth in higher income groups, in exporters. Or, but they look at what has happened in my village. So it's all, I think you said jumla. So that reminds me about actually a leader, and this can be any leader. Don't, you know, I don't mean that one or that one. So he went to a village and he said, what are the two things you want? Come on, just tell me. So one of them said, you know, we don't have a medical, we don't have a doctor that comes. He said, just give me 1 minute. Picks up the phone, he said, He said, done. What is your second wish? He said, you know, we don't have any mobile connectivity in this area. If I can just get one more.
Also, on Shekhar, and one more thing I could say about caste. What do I do if I'm a Yadav and all three candidates are Yadavs? Don't forget that. That often happens.
But there is a Yadav party.
Yeah, but you know, there is, for instance, the Muslims are 20%. Every candidate is a Muslim. There is no Muslim party. Who do I vote for? So I think other things start mattering. It does, you know, it's not, it is a major factor, but it's not the only factor. And I think it would be fair to say that over a period of time, it has become slightly less dominant.
Conventional wisdom is that when one side loses, the loser learns more from the defeat than the winner learns from victory. So who learned more in 2014?
I would say that the BJP is way ahead of Congress in understanding the importance of alliances, importance of even 4% of the vote or 6% of the vote. They are way far superior in terms of negotiating and forming fronts. The Congress is just, and not only this time, historically living, I think you once said, in the 1970s, and they're just unable to understand how important it is to form an alliance. It often reminds me of that story, the Congress reminds me of that story about three parties who might form an alliance, and there's only one test they have to go through. They have to be harnessed to an electric chair one at a time, and if they clear that, then it's okay. So the first party goes to the electric chair, and person presses the button, bloody not working. They said, "Chalo, you're okay, you can go." So, no, they asked him for, "What's your first wish?" So he said, "I want my leader to become prime minister, sit in the chair," and then he went off, very happy. Second person came and they said, "What's your big wish, last wish?" So he said, "I'd like to hear my campaign song and all that." And okay, they said, "Fine, sit down now, you've had your last wish." Sit down, press the button, didn't work. They said, "The rule is, if it doesn't work, you're free to go." So they both went off and formed an alliance. Then the Congress came and they said, "What's your last wish?" And the Congress says, "Last wish, chhad, pehle machine to theek kar."
When we say such things about the BJP, we are trolled mightily by that lot. If we say such things about the Congress party, we are trolled equally mightily. So we are fixed one way or the other. You guys started Sifology. In India. We'll blame you, right? Although the first reference to Sifology, now that we have Uncle or Auntie Google, I checked, the first article on Sifology was written in 1969 in India.
Sifology is a term that came from Oxford with David Butler and his team. And it's from a Greek, the sephos, the pebbles which they used to count votes.
So you guys brought in the craft of using data to look at elections. Not just predicting elections, that's only one part, but attitudes, what people are thinking, what works, what doesn't work. What will be the next thing now, next big thing after data?
What we realize that when we do surveys, we do various checks and balances. Who did you vote for last time, and try and match it with the actual voting last time. But there's a lot of people are scared, people play safe, people don't tell you the whole truth. But you ask 20 questions and you can assess where they may be biased actually. So in that, I feel all of us are a little inadequate in analyzing where people are contradicting each other. And deep learning and AI, I think, is the next step towards interpreting opinion poll finding. And they will be much more accurate.
I have been a market researcher all my life. People do contradict themselves, whether it's soaps, cigarettes, whatever they use. People are not inherently consistent.
Do just the numbers and data work, or there is something else which is more organic, which is more like organic chemistry that we can't easily define, that defies data?
I would say that chemistry and charisma is becoming much less important over the years. We have looked at Indian elections at three phases. The first election was in 52. The first 25 years, 80% of governments were voted back to power. It was pro-incumbency. People had faith in the charisma, in the leadership. The next 25 years, from 77 to 2002, 72% of governments were thrown out of power. So a complete turn from a stars in the eyes, naive, trusting voter to an angry voter. Now you've got a wiser voter. Since 2002, it's 50-50. 50% are voted back, 50% are thrown out. Now, if you've performed on the ground, improved conditions in the village, in my town, I will vote you back. If you haven't, you're out. Development matters much more than earlier, and charisma less. Look at the four or five chief ministers that have been re-elected three times at least. Not people with great charisma or great oratory. Naveen Patnaik, Sheila Dixit, Shivraj Chauhan, Raman Singh. These are not people who are known for their oratory, but they're known for doing things on the ground.
Many politicians in the second phase thought that charisma was not the icing on the cake, but the cake itself. Now they know charisma. Mr. Modi was elected 4 times. So he delivered, and he was a good orator. It doesn't hurt you to be a good orator, a great communicator.
But it's not the...
delivery.
He wasn't elected only because he was a good orator.
No, exactly.
Give much. That's right. It's the delivery that got him back there, not his oratory.
Well, if oratory won you elections, then Lalu Yadav would be our prime minister forever.
That's right.
Or Kanhaiya Kumar now.
My name is Sanjeev Kapoor. A quick question. With all the activities and attempts that the political parties are doing, how much of this NYAY announcement which Congress has made do you think is going to positively impact or not impact the Congress prospects in the coming elections? Question number one. And question number two, million-dollar questions. As we speak, based on whatever you have seen, who's going to win?
First of all, I think I'm not talking about just this, but the general approach to what is a freebie. We must distinguish between handouts which are welfare oriented and handouts which are just freebies, and not club the two together. Giving somebody a grinder or a television set or a mixer.
Mobile phone.
These are freebies. But if you give something to people which changes their life, like Nitish Kumar gave and Mamata Banerjee gave bicycles to school girls that help them go to school and come back. Now that's money just handed out, but that's not a freebie. So it's very important not to just treat every handout as a freebie. If it improves the welfare and the life of the poorest in your society, that is to be applauded and acknowledged and welcomed, and unfortunately it only happens at election time. It's wrong to try and assess a mood by gut feel. I'll tell you why. 1% vote swing gives 18 seats to one side and 18 seats less to, that's 36 seats. 3% is over 100 seats. Can you feel 3%? It's not even right to try.
Working on gut feel, then I think this book wouldn't have been written. This book is all about the lack of gut feel, but the presence of data. You look at data, see what happened. We are looking at historically, of course, but to predict, you know, I have a very rude comment on these matters. What people ask me, I say, only liars, fools, and politicians know what's going to happen. Nobody else does. You know, for instance, let's take Fulwama. Post-Fulwama, can you feel what happened in the guts, in the villages? Who knows? Is it 2%? 2% away? No difference? You know, when you win elections by just small majorities, it is just not. And, you know, particular people who claim to be data scientists, to abandon data and give, you know, I read the same papers as you do. My views no better than yours.
I think increasingly voters now, they believe what they want to believe in terms of who they're already going to vote for. So Mr. Modi's voters think Pulwama, Barakot was a wonderful thing. Those who are not Mr. Modi's voters, it's a lot of people, they say sub propaganda.
Of late, we've seen that often telling people what our political leanings are is now become a negative more than ever. How does it affect a job of a pollster? Does it make your life difficult to conduct exit polls and opinion polls? Because, of course, now you can't freely talk about which side you prefer, number one. Number two, can you talk about an election where you saw significant vote swing happen between the previous government and the upcoming government?
How does the view of the commissioning body, which is NDTV, affect? You see, the person who's participating in the exit poll doesn't know who we are. It goes from an agency. So he says, I'm IMRB or I'm Ansa. Our name is not even mentioned. He says he's doing a poll for a news organization. So I don't think that has any impact on what they say.
Mine is just an observation, which I want you to comment on, which is that how savvy are voters in cities and in villages about the freebie handouts that we were talking about. And that is that, do they realize that somebody has to pay for it and it's not the politicians? Does the man on the ground realize that they're not giving their own money? They're giving the people's money back to the people by not giving them something else which they were supposed to.
Let me tell you, voters in India are savvier than all of us put together. They discuss politics in the villages much more than we do. They're very aware of grassroots problems. And as far as they're concerned, if it's improving my life and some rich guys who are paying tax, it's their tax money, it's about time they paid for us. All of us are a bit negative towards all this. Oh, we're giving handouts. Well, we have, India is socialism for the rich, capitalism for the poor. We have the biggest handouts in all kinds of hidden subsidies, but when they get a handout, we say, oh, it's our taxpayer money going.
No, one second, let me finish. It's a political tool. I'm talking about using it as a political tool, saying that we will now give you the handout that we promised you.
See, it doesn't, to a society and a poor person, whether it's a political tool or not, if it changes their life, it matters to them. And
if it gets
should,
to them.
If it gets to them.
So, Dorab, do you find geographical differences in this? Some states are good at delivery.
Certainly, I think, you know, the southern states in particular are much, much better. You know, when we look at the north, we look at UP and Bihar. They are the big brothers.
The southern kind of at the top, but at the ground it works.
Yes, that's a good way to put it.
In the north, you know, in UP and Bihar, the infrastructure is so poor. And, you know, it's the government official who's finally responsible for the delivery. They are much more politicized, much more lax, much more corrupt. You know, and there is no one to fight for them. I think in the south, there are more and more people. If I don't get my stuff, somebody will get around and scream and shout and rave and rant, and it will get done. I think, you know, the levels of education are also relatively lower in the north. So, you know, all this, you know, as you get more enlightened, educated, as you're more exposed to media, to your rights, I think you rise up a bit more, which has happened in the south, much less so in the north.
Much faster.
Why is it that the opinion polls on different channels vary so much? Don't they all do the same job?
We had access to 833 polls. We worked out, some agencies tend to get it often right, some agencies rarely get it right. You know, there are some errors which arise from your sample size, your sampling errors, your professionalism, and some just arise because you're just giving out a number. I mean, when you don't give out the sample size, the dates of fieldwork, you often wonder whether it's done the study. In fact, in one case, one agency was quoted on two channels with two different numbers. You know, that is a miracle.
So we've tried to point out a way which you can discern a good opinion poll from a bad opinion poll before the forecast, by the sample sizes methodology.
But also, let's bear in mind that in the vast majority of cases, exit polls do get the answer right. Now, the seats are normally out. But what you really want to know is who won. If you won by 30 seats fewer, you're not that bothered, but the other guy wins, then you have a heart attack. So they get this. The winner is almost, if you remove the 2004 election, the India shining election, where everybody got it wrong. The record of exit polls is 94%, which isn't really bad when you think about it.
My name is Vijay Rao. Do you still think that a runoff system might be more representative, or the first-past-the-post system still has its merits?
I think a runoff system is not manageable in India. You take 6 weeks to do one election. Now you want a second election for another 6 weeks? It's a great system. The French have it. I think it's a fabulous system. That the two top people go into a second round. But, you know, it takes us 1.5 months to do the first round. You know, I mean, we'll only have elections all year round.
I would say that the first-past-the-post system, which we inherited from the British, has a lot of inequity in it. And it's not ideal for a big country. For years, the Congress benefited not only from a divided opposition, but from one very important characteristic of the first-past-the-post system. And that is opposition parties whose votes are spread across the country, like the Swatantra who was rising. If it's spread across the country, you get very few seats for every percent of vote. You can get 10-15% of the vote. If it's spread across the country, you'll get two seats.
Unlike
three
it
seats.
Could be in proportional
Unlike proportional representation.
Like, I hope you know that in Poland, the National Beer Drinkers Party won a couple of seats also.
That, I mean,
we do fine here.
That's right.
In that system.
So what we have done, Indians, jugaad, inventive ingeniousness, taken the British first-past-the-post system and reinvented it in a beautiful way. We figured, oh, the spreading across doesn't work. So we have parties emerging with concentrated votes, regional parties. Now, what has happened with that? With regional parties, they've gone from 4% to 35% of the vote. 4%, and then they went to 15%, and they got hardly any seats. Now, with 35% concentrated, they're getting 35% of the seats, just like proportional representation. So we've taken first past the post, jugaded, and made it, we call it JFTP, jugar first past the post, and made it proportional representation. So teach the British a thing or two.
My name is Madhu Terdar. Is it really the true that the developmental work, the villages are working? Villagers, I have seen, they don't ask for a dam or a rural. They do ask, but nobody, no concerted efforts will be done to achieve that. Finally, they will be compromised with the kind of a money they get or a boost. That is my observation. I'll be very happy to have more clarification on that. Thank you.
I think what we have done is try to look at data across the country, and it tends to show now that sitting MPs or MLAs renominated, by and large, on average, have a 50% chance of winning again. So it's not that they're all thrown out. New candidates have only a 37% chance. And most parties renominate about 67 2/3 of their sitting candidates. If you've done good work and if you've been visiting, they need to see you. And that is why MPs are now much less important to voters than MLAs and panchayat leaders and municipal leaders. The turnout for assembly elections is much higher than for Lok Sabha elections. So visibility, contact, not just they come at election time and then disappear into the Lok Sabha and you don't see them for 5 years.
Well, I mean, if you look at a state like DMK, like Tamil Nadu, DMK, ADMK, everybody pays the voters, but one side wins.
Correct.
Yeah.
But in general, the amount of money being spent in elections is obscene, both officially and unofficially. Officially, there is no cap on party spend. There is a cap on individual spend, which is ridiculous.
Just on the lighter note, Pranay, I'm told that your maternal grandfather, Paresh Lal Roy, was called father of Indian boxing,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
So what did you learn from him? Did you learn any boxing tricks while analyzing election studies?
I learned a lot from him. He was a great man. He learned a lot. He said one thing, which got me into the school boxing team. But I think I figured I'm much better at Bhangra than boxing.
Yeah, lovely, lovely.
He taught me the straight left and he said,
yeah,
never lose your temper in a fight.
Wonderful.
Then you lose the might. You lose the fight.
You know, Pranay, last year in the print, I argued rather in a very controversial way, my new work around what I call presidential prime ministers. Cut to 2019 elections, I'm looking at my own piece and related work. I'm trying to remind ourselves, you know, both cephalologists and political scientists, to what extent have we ever analyzed the effect of this new emerging trend of presidential prime minister?
Around the world, with the spread of media, all elections tend to become somewhat presidential. But the question is, we have a large number of presidents. For instance, in Tamil Nadu, M.K. Stalin is the president, and Mr. O.P.S. is the president. Then T.R.S. is the president. Then Naveen is... So it's a personality-based election, that's true. Personalities are becoming much more important because we are seeing them so much more easily because of the spread of media. I think that's happening not just in India, around the world.
Hi, my name is Nitin Bhatia. Just a question about, the rural voter. Does the rural voter differentiate between an assembly election and a Lok Sabha election in the sense, does he understand that, you know, voting for an... I'm just taking a UP example. BSP and SP coming together may or may not be able to form the government, but voting for a Congress or a BJP, there's a more likely chance that a government will be formed, a more stable government will be formed?
Can I answer that question?
Yeah, please.
I think it's much more likely to understand than an urban voter, that I can tell you.
The
urban voter is probably the least interested and the least literate. You know, when you're an MLA, you come to me. I mean, how many of us know who are MLAs here? How many of us know are MPs? Yeah, but you know, I don't see too many hands going up. So my point is that I think it affects his life. He sees the person, like the municipal corporator comes to his place to ask for his vote. If he has a problem, he can go to him.
Okay, in villages, they know more, they can talk more intelligently on politics than most panelists on our TV channels, which is not saying very much, but they actually can. And they will tell you, wo Thakur hai, wo Brahmin hai, wo Bhumihar hai, wo idhar hai, wo udhar hai. They know everything.
Hi, my name is Malini, and you know, in the last several elections, every election has been fought on a certain plank. 2004, India shining, rural distress. 2009 was re-election for Congress, nuclear deal, whatnot. 2014 was anti-corruption, quite clearly. What is the core real issue that both sides are going to go to fight on or go to the people with the electorate with?
The fact of the matter is that I think we in the national media simplify elections too much, that there's one big issue and this is going to be Modi versus Rahul. It just is nothing like that. It's one really intelligent MLA told us, it's like an exam paper. You have about 10 answers and you've got to get score well in all the answers. You just can't do one. So this election, more so than any other election, and it's a trend over time, is not a national election, it's a federation of states election. Each state is totally different from another state. Like what happens in Tamil Nadu is completely different to Orissa, completely different to Andhra, completely different to Karnataka, Bengal. And we kind of say, oh, this is Modi versus Rahul. No, it isn't.
A government in power normally runs on its record, because you can't erase your record. An opposition normally runs on what it plans to do. I mean, Mr. Modi last time in addition to the Congress corruption rang on a chedin. Now people will ask, how much was delivered? And the Congress is making promises. So they'll have to weigh between the two.
War or the threat of war, how much important is this vis-a-vis these factors? And of course, it's a topical question for India, but generally, how does one analytically think about this when we are thinking about, so to use a game theoretic language, whether it can be used as a strategic device by political parties also?
I don't think you can really analyze the effect. There is time over which effect, any effect wears off. Any freebie you give, for instance, any welfare thing you do, people forget. So, you know, as Harold Wilson once said, another quote, a week is a long time in politics. So something that happens 3 weeks later, people may remember or may not remember. I think it just is too difficult to put a number on what this. All I can say is Fulbawa won't hurt Mr. Modi. Now, the extent which will help him, I have no way to know. Let's look back to a similar case, Kargil. Mr. Vajpayee didn't get more seats. It happened. But it could happen this time the other way. One just doesn't know, because you're assuming it's the only factor. If we were today fight, if on the day of the election we're actually fighting the war, it would be another factor. But if you're not, one doesn't know. The effect is there, it's worn off. One just doesn't know.
I'm Meena Sivan. I just want to ask you, the sophologist, how much of the perceptions and the recency effects matter in the election mode, right?
The average voter goes beyond jumla. They go beyond just oratory now. They go beyond just promises. They want to see efficient implementation. And in their village, that's what matters.
But if it matters, they know for the last 10 years, Congress did not do the same thing, right? So why are they still hopeful of coming back?
Now, that's a good question. There are two factors that always affect an election vote. One is it's got to be important to the voter, like the bridge or corruption or some issue that's important, number one. Number two, they have to see one side better than the other at fixing it. You can't just have a very important issue but both are useless. Like Chor Ramaswamy said to me, we're voting between a pickpocket and a thief. So corruption is never an issue. But if one side, like actually in the Delhi elections, the Aam Aadmi Party stood apart from being apparently a non-corrupt party, while all the others were seen as corrupt. And that became an issue. Although corruption is really important in people's lives. And by the way, they are very clear they don't really trust the media, honestly. We think we have a huge impact. Politicians think we have a huge impact. We overestimate the impact of the media on the electorate. They watch everything. They have WhatsApp. This is almost a WhatsApp election. They have Facebook, but they make up their own minds and they know the biases of different channels. So they're not just gullible anymore.
Good evening. This is Shalini Asher. I wanted to ask you that increasingly it's very obvious that the media houses are pro or anti one or the other angle and parties. It's very obvious increasingly. But what I want to ask is how much, this is more directly towards NDTV and the print, how much do you get affected when one phase or one party or one government turns against you?
It's tough, yeah. We are fighting.
NDTV is probably the only well-known channel that has been harassed by the Congress government and the BJP government. That just shows where NDTV lies. You find me one other major channel that has been harassed by both governments.
And I about the print, I will tell you, perhaps the only ones who get trolled by both.
Both sides.
I mean, if it's Friday, it must be the BJP. If it's Saturday, it must be the Congress. So, in fact, in our office, I usually have a banner that says, the left thinks we are right, the right thinks we are left. So we must be doing something right.
This is off the cuff, but a lot of big news is censored by mainstream media of late.
Like what?
Like the caravan story that just came out, or the trucker strike. Trucker strike, I mean, it was there in bits and pieces, but when you had a trucker strike, it would have been a huge issue in any other times, but it wasn't.
I think it is a worrying trend that stories are suppressed. But fortunately, as Shekhar says, there are alternative media, there's social media, and there's alternative forms of expression. So just the big media houses are not as monopolistic, or as, they don't dominate as much as they used to, which is a very good thing. Social media in this election is going to play a huge role, and it has a very positive role, but it also has a negative side to it, in the sense that a lot of hate and violence and fake news is spread on social media. And the problem with social media is that is anonymity. It's both its strongest point, the beauty of the internet is anonymity, and it's also its biggest flaw. Because if you're anonymous, you can't be traced as to spreading hatred and violence. So what we've tried to suggest is that don't touch the anonymity, except in the rarest of rare cases. And people should know that you can be identified in the rarest of rare cases, and that too only by the judicial system, not by the government.
Well, I'll just add to that, that this is a very polarized time. So the media also gets generally divided in two categories. One is chamcha, the other is morcha. So in the middle of that, to do real journalism has become very challenging. Because whatever you do, you're guaranteed to get abuse or have your motives questioned by the side that doesn't like it. So ultimately, you have to leave it to the readers, watchers, listeners to figure out who they trust and who.
So I think all three of you are neither for a political party nor against a political party. And all three of you speak from your heart, write from your heart. And that is why we admire you and we come to listen to you. I watch NDTV, I read all your articles, Shekhar, and I watch television when Dorabji is there. So during election time and otherwise. We come because you are friends and you are true people. You write what is needed to be written without fear or favor.
Thank you, Deepak. Once, when you get praise, take it. But that's because you also speak from the heart. So please keep speaking that way.
How much of a factor will jobs be, or the lack of them be, in swinging this election? And will the government pay for the fact that they have concealed job statistics and data relating to unemployment over the last few months?
There is an actual absence of jobs.
Yeah.
That is going to make a difference. You know, when you go to a village, all say, Berozgari is the main problem. A couple of years ago, we were in Punjab, and we saw this man. He's an M-Tech. What's he doing? He's sitting at his brother's shop, where there are six carpenters working for him and his brother. They used to work for his brother alone. Now that he has nothing to do, he sits in the same shop, gets a sec. They split the income. But the question is, you know, that is not employment. There is, you know, people ask often on television, if you're growing at 7.5%, shouldn't there be employment? Let me give a simple quote from an article written by Arvind Panagriya, who was the Niti Aayog head. He said, for every $2.2 million of investment, Reliance Industries creates one job. For every $2.2 million of investment, an organized body called Shlok Exports from Bangalore, which is the largest garment exporter, creates 266 jobs. So the question is, you can put in a lot of investment, but the question is the investment job creating? I would be surprised if in Jamnagar, which is the largest refinery in the world, there are more than 10,000 workers. We need to create jobs, so we need to be, you know, instead of being a demographic dividend, it's going to be a demographic disaster unless we start creating jobs. We have to help creating jobs in industries that are labor intensive, not that are capital intensive.
Mansi Fadke, I work with the Print in Mumbai. Two questions. One is, what role are regional parties likely to play this election? Because you said that the benefit of both the parties goes to the alliance plus a swing of up to 8%. And both national parties are scrambling at this point, the BJP better than the Congress. And secondly, the WhatsApp election, most of the fake messages, hate messages are spread on WhatsApp, and the question of anonymity doesn't really arise here because you're always getting it from somebody you know. One person forwards it to another, that person forwards it to somebody else he knows. To what extent do people actually trust this, and to what extent will this impact this election, because it's a new phenomena as such?
Well, I'd say WhatsApp, when you forwarded something, you don't know who it's from because you don't know who they got it from or who they got it from. So you don't know the origin of the creator of the fake news. And that is a major danger, and it's exploited by people who live off hatred, right? And also, and I hate to say this, it happens a lot in America, there's the dark arts of voter suppression. Dark arts of voter suppression, where in America they've made sure that certain kinds of communities and people cannot come out and vote. Now, if you don't want a particular community or women to come out in a particular area, you create tension and violence. So it does affect turnout. So there are a lot of negatives involved. And India is getting smart enough to realize that turnout is important in elections. It's not just swing. And these things do affect. But yes, I do feel social media, by and large, is positive. But anonymity allows too much hatred on it.
You also asked about regional parties. As we said earlier, regional parties have become important. Alliances have become important. So as Pranoy said, the BJP is so much better at forming alliances. Like, there's one case of alliance which is fabulous for the BJP. They had 21 seats in Bihar, one in the bag. They said, we'll fight 17. So they said, we'll give up four of our seats because we want an alliance. Now, you know, which party would do that? I mean, that is what, because the final objective of politics is to win an election, not to lose an election gloriously. So you do what it takes. And this, I've not seen a better example than this, than you said to four of your MPs, you will not fight this time because I want to give the seat to my ally. So I think, you know, that is what building consensus, building an election, winning an election is all about.
Do you think that with 30, 40 leaders now, each one with a vote bank, it's now, there is no leader in this country who can breach any of these vote banks?
I tend to agree, yes. They are solid. They are contrary to what media believes. They are additive. When two big leaders come together, their supporters do vote together. And they listen, and the data shows it, and our on-the-field experience also shows it.
Vote transfer?
Vote transfer is
a reality?
In fact, we don't, you know, we've given some data in the book where we looked at four or five by-elections that have taken place recently and said these parties got together, say in Gorakhpur, in Fulpur, in Kairana. Were the votes additive? They were additive. Not only were they additive, as Pranoy said earlier, there is an extra bump because you think, now I've got a chance to win. You know, we are like the United States of Europe. We are not one, we are a, You know, we are a geographical entity. The people are different, the religion is different, the castes are different, the food habits are different, the languages are different. We just became one country. So now we are finding that we have a large number of countries in a federation. And that's how we are voting, as a federation.
To sum up, we can say that era of one-man elections nationally is over, or it hasn't come back yet. But the era of many one-man or one-woman elections is with us to stay.
Absolutely. Well put.
I got the last word in to impress all of you and them, so that soon I am at the other end. These two are interviewing me, but for that I have to write a book first, which I must tell you is an act of great bravery. So congratulations for having done it, and we've had a great conversation. And thank you very much for watching. Watch this on NDTV and on the print. And remember, these are the two sources of news that you can trust, because we are neither, definitely not chamchas, and definitely not anybody's morchas. Thank you very much for watching.
Thank you.